Here this evening, and we're looking forward to a really blessed night this evening. So we're going to start with that well-known hymn, "Can People of the Risen King." So please do sing along, help us out.
Yeah. so much. Great job, great job. Hi everyone, good evening, and absolutely fantastic to have the band leading us tonight. Got a number of friends I'd love to introduce tonight. My name's Rhys, I'm the pastor at New Hope, and I've been here a few times before at Ebenezer, looking forward to being here on Sunday morning as well. But I'd love to introduce our worship pastor, and we're proud to say 6 times Grammy nominated, Zeke Lisenby. Thank you so much, brother. And it's been Zeke's vision in the past. We kind of just brought the music from Atlanta, but it's Zeke's vision very much to include others as well. And to have this amazing talent here tonight is really brilliant. And so I hope we'll see more of that. And we'd love to develop that more. And I've got another friend I'll introduce to you in a moment, but we're so blessed of Mal Pope here tonight, everybody, whose name almost goes without introduction. Let's give it up for Mal. And first recorded with his first album with Elton John back in the 70s when Elton was the biggest music act in the world, actually, 1973, 74. And he was only 12. And an illustrious singer, songwriter, and writer of musicals. And I loved your musical on the Welsh Revival, which I'm going to talk about a little bit later. Some of us were able to watch that a few years ago. And we're very thankful for Mal's broadcasting. Who listens to BBC Radio Wales still? Give me a wave if you do. I do as well, by the way, even in Atlanta. So Mal's frequently on Radio Wales. I've got to tell you this story as well, that a little while ago, Mal, I was messaging Mal on Twitter, and he says, hey, I'm on the radio right now, and is there a song you want to play? And so this song popped into my head. It's like, it was by U2 called All I Want Is You. I just thought it was a nice, easy song. It was 5 in the morning, your time. It was midnight in Atlanta. I thought it'd be a nice, easy song. Didn't realize that the last minute was like a really weird, piece of music playing anyway. So there you go. It just sounded like the White Album from the Beatles. There you go. So, but so glad to have Zeke here. So glad to have Mal here. And we've got every main event that we're doing this week, we've got an international rugby player who's going to be with us. And by the way, there are 5 or 6 different events taking place tonight. There are men's events, women's events, and so all over the valleys locally and in other valleys as well. So please pray that God will move during this time. But our special guest is no stranger, I think, to most people in this community, a man of Blaenau Gwent. But Byron Hayward has played rugby for Wales and really been involved in top flight rugby for more than 30 years. And then, of course, was a defense coach for the Scarlets when they became the champions. He's on 2 different phases, headed up the Wales under-20s, and, of course, been defense coach for our nation as well. So we're very proud of our local man. And actually, many of you might have heard Byron's testimony in the past. I asked Byron, maybe you can share something about some of the struggles that you've been through, and you just give the word that God's got for you tonight, Byron. But I know that many of us have gone through a lot of struggles. Give me a wave if you've been through 1 or 2 struggles along the way. Yeah, and so whenever you speak to that, people are always interested. So shall we welcome our local brother? We appreciate so much. Let's give it up for Byron Hayward, everybody. Thank you, Byron.
Hello. Can you hear me all? Right. I think I'd rather play in front of 50,000 people, to be honest, than do this. Just a little story about Rhys, actually. I've known Rhys a few years now, and just going back to the Welsh job when I got selected really to coach Wales. It was 3 years ago, 2020, Six Nations, and it's the first game in the Six Nations. Rhys was there with his wife Louise. It's all right, you come to the captain's run day before, and then there for the game. So Wales have never... I can't remember the last time they've had a 0. So I'm a defence coach, which basically, in simple terms, is you have to stop the opposition scoring. So Wales have never had a 0, ever. And Sean Edwards, Warren Gatland, they won Grand Slams, loads of things, but never had a 0. So my first game for Wales against Italy at home in the Six Nations, we win 42-0. And so... this is a short story, this is. Because I don't believe it's nothing to do with me at all. I put it down to the divine intervention with Rhys being there. It had to be. But what happened after that game was, a couple of days after that, Rhys went home. And then we didn't win another game, and I got sacked. So, Rhys, if you'd stayed in the country, I'm sure I'd still be there now. Don't want to put you on a guilt trip. Anyway, So Rhys said to me about giving my testimony, and I thought I'd rather maybe speak about things that's relevant to us all, because it's boring speaking about yourself. I find it boring. I'm sure you all would as well. And it's on YouTube. It's been on there for about 8 years. And so if you want to go and have a look at that, you can. But so first of all, what I tend to do now is that, and it's exciting leading this type of Christian life, it's sort of like give control to the higher power, the higher intelligence. So I just pray about whatever I need to do and let God give me it, and I go with it. So I don't really prepare, and I haven't prepared massively for this tonight. And I just see what he gives me, and I've had a few points have come to me, and the first one is about non-judgment, because we live in a world where everyone's got an opinion, particularly with rugby in Wales. It's about non-judgment. So tonight, whatever I say, I'm not judging nobody, and hopefully I'll have the same return. But it's a challenge for us as human beings, isn't it? When I think about non-judgment, it's like, could everyone here who are Christians, go to church regularly, love Jesus, put your hands up, just raise your hands if you could, please. Okay, so if you're not, no problem. That's good. Okay, so if you're not, don't worry, you're welcome here, probably more than we are as Christians. But it's really interesting that out there in the world, that if somebody asks us that question, maybe in a pub or somewhere where there's not many Christians about, would be all probably a bit like, yeah, because it's difficult out there. Same, I guess, if you're a non-Christian here tonight, where most of the people are, probably want to put your hand up because you don't want to be left out and feel not part of this environment. And the same as us when we're out there sometimes, don't we have that doubt, fear, and you don't really want to, because when we're in here, we're all like, yeah, we're Christians, aren't we? And I've been like that. Not anymore, thankfully. But and that's where it is. It's fear and doubt, isn't it? And for me, it's about, if you're a Christian, you know that fear and doubt comes from the enemy, which is real. And so I'm a Christian who says things as it is. I'm not fluffy. And the enemy is Satan, simple as that. I mean, if you're a non-Christian, do you refer to it as the negative voice in your head? So we all have it, whether you're a believer or not a believer. There's a negative voice in there. Imposter syndrome, I hear it called. But the reality is, and if we're not open and honest about that, is evil forces in this world. And Satan's alive and well and in this world. And if you don't believe me, put the news on tonight at 10 o'clock and you will see him everywhere over it. There'll be wars, corruption everywhere, child abuse is there. And that's the reality. But the good news is, and this is my second point really, is Satan's here, yeah, but Jesus is alive. And I've experienced that so profoundly the last couple of years of my life. And it's going through troubles and the turbulent times, as Rhys spoke about. And I'm not up here, it's not a pity party. So, and I know you've all been through similar things as well. So obviously losing my job, which is not a big thing because a lot of people lose jobs, but it got prayed out in public, it's national TV. I know everyone has opinion on it. And you have the feelings of letting your family down. You feel a failure. It's difficult, it's tough. During that process, rejection, betrayal of people you think close to you, close friends. And during those times as well, you know, we lost close family members, as I'm sure you all have here, and grief is a tough thing, as you all know. But for me, so, you know, in those times, I've experienced, and during probably the last 12 months more than anything, like, that's why I say Jesus is alive, because I have experienced it personally. And don't get me wrong, there have been some tough times when you wake up in the middle of the night and you're in the bathroom and you're like, it's just like, God, where are you? But this is my last point. It's about using your faith. You know, like to say you have a faith, but if you don't use it, and that's what I wasn't doing. So I should have been saying, instead of saying, God, where are you? I should have been saying, God, I know this is tough. I'm going through a tough time. But I know you're there with me. And that's his word. It says that time and time again in the Bible. And the word is the truth. And the word is power. So for me, it's about, and for us who are Christians, the Spirit of Jesus lives in you. When we get baptized, we're baptized with the Holy Spirit, right? So that's the Spirit of Jesus. It's in you. But unless you use your faith, it will just lie dormant in the pit of your soul. And I've experienced that because I wasn't using my faith. And you might think, well, how do you use your faith? So it's about speaking positive words of belief and encouragement to yourself. Like I should have been doing. I should have been saying, I know this is tough. I'm going through a really bad time. But I know you're here with me, Lord. Because I'm here now in a better place than I've been for I don't know how many years. I'm probably working in a job now where I'm earning a quarter of the money I was when I was coaching Wales. So all those external things people think, you know, the fame and fortune in Wales, it's pointless, it's useless. So my point is, like, for us as Christians, use our faith by being positive, encouraging, talking back to the negative voice, the enemy, in your head, because it's there and it's real and we all have it. That's how you defeat the enemy. And that's what I've experienced in my life. I mean, for example, it's about speaking positive words, but I think it's all about positive actions as well. And for us as Christians, and for myself as well, and I've done this recently, would we have the courage out there in the world to, you know, someone sick, put your arms around someone and pray, knowing that they will be healed. Knowing that they will be healed. That's what our challenge is as Christians, and that's what using your faith is. So hopefully what I want to get across is, don't have a faith that is dormant. Have a faith that's strong and exercised and used. Use your faith. So I don't plan for this, so whatever comes to me is coming from the higher power, right? So, and for me, all my life, it's been about being aggressive. Aggression in rugby, right from I played since I was 10, 11 years old. In the boxing ring, boxing, it's been about aggression. But now, thankfully, I'm aggressive with using my faith. And that is my daily challenge, and I want to do that, and that's why I'm here tonight. Because when you get up here and you do this, you have a lot of negative thoughts in your head for the last few days, and what are you going to say, and people are going to think it's a little rubbish, all the bad things in it. So I'm exercising my faith. But yeah, just an encouragement to you all. You know, we all have these challenges, whether you believe or don't believe. But all I know is that Jesus is alive, and the power that's in the cross, my last bit, sorry, I've gone, it's going somewhere else, but it is, it's the power that's in the cross. It's that, because we all think the cross is a place of sadness, which it was, and every Good Friday, I end up going to church and crying, and I don't know why, but I do know why, but it happens, and I can't stop it. But, so we think the cross is like Jesus got beaten to death, and were nailed to the cross for a wretch like me. I'm the worst sinner in this place. But we just think, and that's it. That's the redemption. And I can look forward to a life in heaven. Because we're only in this journey 5 minutes. We'll be gone before long. I won't be the negative and down, but that's the fact. It goes like in the blink of an eye. The next one is forever. But for me, it's the power that's in the cross. Because that's what I said, use your faith, because the power of Jesus is inside all of you who've been baptized. And that's what happened to the apostles, wasn't it? The early church, why this building's here, and millions of others around the world, is that the apostles, when Jesus died, so there was no church before Jesus when he was alive, the church was formed after, wasn't it? So the apostles in Acts went out, and that's what they did. They went out and healed people, and everyone goes, like, unbelievable miracles. So what we have is this unworthiness of thinking, and I've had it, or you, I'm sure you all had it. It's like, I can't go and heal people. I'm just a useless sinner. I got a faith, but I can't do that. Well, the apostles was exactly the same. The St. Paul was probably the worst, wasn't he? You know, persecuted Christians, murdered them, killed Christians, hated them. And then he had to have an experience on the road to Damascus, didn't he? And then get blinded for a few days before he could reopen his eyes and then go, yeah, I can see the power now. But all that power is available to all of us who are Christians. And if you're here and you're not a Christian and you want that power, go and get yourself baptized. Amen. That's my Lord.
Stay up here, Byron. Hey, thank you so much for sharing. And about 3 or 4 years ago, Byron, Garen Jenkins, and Emmy Lewis, and they're all going to be with us this week, you gave a testimony on Songs of Praise. And so that was the whole nation. And so I don't know, a million or so people watched that. Man, spiritual warfare came from that as well. But I thought, like, the massive joy is going to be Byron's going to win a Grand Slam. And then you describe what happened. But actually, isn't the glory that a Christian goes through hard times and can stand before a group of people and say, Jesus Christ is alive? Isn't that the greatest thing of all, everyone, I think? And that's an encouragement to every one of us who's going through hard times, that we want to get the victory, we want to get the glory, we want to get another number one. Mal's had a number one this year, actually. But the glory's not always the number one, is it? But sometimes it's playing with the grandkids, and it's just knowing that God's in our life. So let me pray for you, and then Zeke's going to come up. Heavenly Father, just thank you for my dear brother. Lord, I've seen him do defense talks in front of a talented squad, and here he is, vulnerable in that sense, because when we talk about you, Lord, we've got nothing. We've only got your grace and what Jesus has done for us. And so just thank you for Byron. I pray you continue to grow him in the faith. Pray for his brothers and my brother, Emir and Garen, as they testify as well in other places, Resolven tomorrow and across the valleys. We pray, Lord, that you'll use us, that you'll be glorified. And as we continue to praise you, just draw Jesus close to us. We ask this in Jesus' name. Everybody said, amen. Let's give it up for Byron one more time, everyone. And welcome, Zeke.
Hey, everybody. How are you doing tonight? Are you doing good? Are you doing good? So this is something that we do at our church, and I think we can do it on this side of the pond. I need you to stand up. That's step one. I hear groans. And I need for you, there's one thing I've loved about, this is my second year coming to Wales. One of the things I have loved about coming to Wales is that everybody speaks to each other. I walk up and down the street, it's like, hey, how are you doing? It's like, hey, how are you doing? I'm like, this is better than the South in America. This is kind of nice. So what I want you to do, there may be some people in here that this is their first time at this church or their first time in church, period. I want you to go out of your way to go find two people that you do not know and say, I am so glad that you're here. That means now. You can move and go find two people and say, I am so glad that you're here. Let's start it over. Start it over. All right, we're going to sing a song for you, and I may ask you to do a little physical participation, which is called clapping. Everybody clap with me once. Clap with me twice. You qualify. All right, let's go ahead and start the song. This song is called Lion and the Lamb. You may not know it, but the words are going to be up on the screen, and we're going to sing together and just enjoy being together tonight. Amen? Amen? Amen. All right, here we go. The song sounds like this. It says, he's coming on the clouds, King
kings and kingdoms will bow down.
I think you guys know this, don't you? Sing along with me.
And every chain will break as broken hearts declare his praise. For who can stop the Lord Almighty?
And here's the chorus. It says,
our God is the lion, the lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles. And every knee will bow before him. Yeah. Our God is the lamb that was slain for the sins of the world. His blood breaks the chain.
Yeah.
And every knee will bow before the lion and the lamb. And every knee will bow before.
Let's clap those hands again, everybody. Come on, as we celebrate Jesus. So open up.
So open up. The gates.
Yeah.
Make way before the kingdom.
Hallelujah. The song says, our God has come to save.
Our God has come to save. He's here to set the captives free. But who can stop the Lord Almighty?
Come on, won't you lift up your voice tonight and say,
our God is the lion, the lion of Judah.
Next part of the song is just a rhetorical question, and the answer is no, but we're going to ask it anyway, okay? All right, let's see if you know the bridge. It says,
for who can stop the Lord Almighty?
No one. You say it, come on.
No one. No one.
Everybody say now,
who can stop the Lord Almighty?
No one, no one.
Who can stop the Lord Almighty?
No one.
Who can stop the Lord Almighty?
Now watch me right here.
Who can stop the Lord?
All right, let's clap one more time. Come on, let's celebrate. With a voice of triumph. Amen. 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 You guys are singing loud. You kind of scared me there for a second. I was like, whoa, they're like really singing loud. This next song that we're going to do talks about the name of Jesus. The name of Jesus is so important. God says he gives him a name that's above every other name. Now, on your daily basis, you hear a lot of different names, right? Sometimes you may hear the name divorce. Sometimes people hear the name cancer. Sometimes people hear the word anger. But there is a name that is above all of those names. That name is Jesus. Amen. And in that name, there is healing, there's salvation, there's deliverance. Anything that you're walking through, I was talking to someone earlier today. I had a cousin who was on drugs for years and years, stealing out of people's homes. His life was a complete mess. But because of Jesus, 20 years later, the Lord has done miraculous things in his life, and it was only because of Jesus. And so that's the name. Let's go ahead and start the track. That's the name that we want to celebrate tonight, and that's a beautiful name, is that name is Jesus. Amen? Hallelujah.
You are the Word in the beginning.
Come on.
One with God, the Lord Most High.
Yeah.
Your hidden glory in creation, now revealed in you are.
If you know it, sing it.
What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. The name.
Sing this next verse together. Hallelujah. You didn't want heaven without us.
You didn't want heaven without us. So Jesus, you brought heaven down. My sin was great, your love was greater.
The next part of the song, because it explains exactly what God did for us through Jesus, and it's a marvelous thing that he has done for us. Has anybody ever experienced Jesus before? Well, I pray tonight before you leave, if you've never experienced him before, that the presence of God would fall on you and that you would experience Jesus. Now, we're going to tell you the story, and it says,
death could not hold. There's time before you, you silence the boast of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring, the praise of your glory, for you are raised to life again.
And guess what?
You have no rival. You have no equal.
Amen. 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 You may be seated. You may be seated. Next, you guys can go be seated too. Amen. Was that song a blessing to you? Amen. For the six people that responded, I'm glad that it was a blessing to you. We have a wonderful, wonderful person that I've had a chance to encounter because he's such a force to be reckoned with, Mr. Mal Pope. I got a chance to meet him last year at my first time coming here to Wales, and I didn't realize that I was in the room with a legend and just someone who is just phenomenal and probably the most talented person in Wales. No pressure. Probably the most talented person in Wales. And so we're so excited to have him with us tonight. Can we celebrate Mr. Mal Pope tonight?
Goodness me, if I'm that good, I can't wait myself.
Okay. Lovely to be with you in Abertillery. Isn't it a strange world that we live in that Zeke from Mississippi and Maldwin from Brynhyfryd in Swansea could be making music today? Do you know the funny thing was? I came in and I had a song and I had a guitar and I was going to just sing it on my own, and then Zeke started playing, playing like you're doing now. And I realized it actually sounds better when Zeke plays it than I do. So I'm thinking about you, Byron. A song for you tonight. Somebody there called out my name, turning my scream into a whisper. And you took my hand and you led me home. And you said I'd never be alone. So what am I really doing here? Where am I gonna find an answer? 'Cause the darkness just keeps rolling in. Just don't know where to begin, so I just breathe. Say your name as I breathe in. Call for the comforter to come to hold me up and make me strong. Soul to keep, and I just breathe. Maybe the message wasn't clear. Maybe I wasn't really listening. But inside I know I wasn't wrong. But it's just so hard to keep on going. So I just breathe. Say your name as I breathe in. I call for the comforter to come to hold me up and make me strong. I'm asking you, my soul, to keep. I just breathe. Ooh. Ooh. times I would run away, given half the chance. Somebody said you would open the doors. I'm just praying it'll happen quickly. As the Furies fight to steal my peace, oh, I'm just praying for that sweet release. So I just breathe. Say your name as I breathe in. Talk about you in my sleep. Oh, I'm asking you, Lord, my soul. It's the second time we've played that song ever in my lifetime, and I've had a long lifetime, I can tell you that. We're gonna teach you a song now, okay? We're gonna teach you a song. It's called My God is Mighty, and He can do anything, He can do it all, He can do it all. Okay, it's quite simple, so I'll just do the chorus. So my God is mighty, and He can do anything, He can do it all. He can do it all. He can move mountains if your faith means anything. He can do it all. So that's the chorus. We'll sing it a number of times. In 10 minutes' time, you're going to be fed up of it. Okay. It's funny, falling in love. Do you remember when you fell in love, Reese? Do you remember that moment of falling in love? I'm in love with black gospel music, and I've had the joy of traveling down through Mississippi. Where in Mississippi are you from?
New Albany.
New Albany. It's not very far from Tupelo?
20 minutes.
20 minutes from Tupelo. For 5 years, I used to judge the Elvis Presley Songwriting Festival in Tupelo, Mississippi. That sounds daft, doesn't it? It's absolutely true. I'm not making it up. You're hard to convince. I'm looking straight into your eyes. You're not even, it's like, there's no reaction. But was it there that I fell in love with black gospel music? Was it there? No. Memphis, the home of the civil rights movement, spending time with the Reverend Samuel Billy Kiles, the man who invited Martin Luther King to Memphis for the garbage worker strike, a lovely, lovely choir in his Baptist church. Was it there, Reese, I fell in love with black gospel music? See, we're getting the hang of it now. I fell in love with black gospel music in a little place, Zeke, called Port Talbot. The Avenlido, 1976. I'd gone, how much time? I might have gone on. Do you know what? I went to a prison once to play. And I'm sat around a circle there, and I say to the pastor, I'm really sorry, I'm rambling on. I said, how much time have I got? He said, the guy next to me said, don't worry, you've got 6 months. I went to see a concert with, it was Pat Boone, Coriel Lerner, a Swedish choir, and I was dragged along by the youth minister. Girls, you know what that's like. You're dragged along, you have to go. And then on came Andre Crouch. 4 foot tall, 5 foot wide, he's a dynamo. Andre Crouch and the Disciples. And from that moment on, I realized that I was going to give my life, well, partly, to black gospel music. Oh, anyway, so Zeke plays on the new record, and he recorded all his bits in Atlanta, and it starts like this.
Had a problem when you couldn't see the end from the beginning. listen to me. Take it all to Jesus. Take it today. 'Cause he's got all the answers. He walked the same way. My God is mighty, and he can do anything. He can do it all. He can do it all. He can move mountains if your faith means anything. He can do it all. Have you ever walked on your own down a long dark road, frightened by the darkness? You're so weary from your load. Take one look beside you, then you will know. Jesus, he is waiting. He's gonna show you the way to go. Chorus time, here we go. My God is mighty, and he can do anything. He can do it all.
Yes, he can. Yes, he can.
He can move mountains if your faith means anything. He can do it all.
Yes, he can.
Change key, aren't we?
You'll be all right.
My God is mighty, and he can do anything. He can do it all.
Yes, he can.
Come on, let's praise the Lord one more time. Come on, everybody. That was really amazing. Wow. Thank you so much. I think something happened during that song as well. Truth on Fire. And thank you, guys. It's a joy for me to see friends here tonight just sharing together, and to be able to share it with you is such a blessing. And I'm looking forward to, hey, we're just kicking off tonight. Amen. And please pray for us as we go to Resolven. You're welcome to join us, by the way. Come every night if you want to. Resolven, Sardist Baptist Resolven. We're finishing off at your church. I hear you sing just about every week when I look at what your Pastor John preaches and posts on the internet there. But Abba Sucken, we're going to finish off on the Sunday night. And so please stay connected with our story. I feel very much like Byron tonight as well. Byron, just like, Lord, what do you want me to say tonight? Now, I've prepared for this, perhaps more than any talk that I've done all year. We do have an incredible church. Please pray for me, because I preach at our South Campus and then go to the North Campus about 20 minutes away and preach later that morning. We're doing a second service at the South Campus, and Pastor Zeke is going to lead the worship for all three of those services. I'm going to preach all of them, and so there's a lot of preparation time that we need, and it goes out on the radio and all that kind of stuff. A lot of people listen, but I want to tell you, this is really important to me, because I know that we want to encourage you, and we're here to lift you all up, and I pray that God will bless us. But one of the questions I often ask, you know, we moved to America in 2005 to become the pastor at New Hope. Previously, I was at the church in Holland Road, Brighton, and we've got some Holland Roaders who are a big part of this team, about half of the team. And so when I'm, you know, I've come back a lot since then, as you probably can imagine, but I always ask the question, like, what's going on? What's the big story in Wales? And sometimes it's important just to ask the question and try and figure out. And if you ask people what's going on, they'll tell you. They'll tell you, especially in Wales, as to what the big story is. But, you know, I keep pretty close to the sort of day-to-day news stories like you do as well, because I you know, subscribe to some of those papers. I actually do listen to BBC Radio Wales, and I do read the Western Mail as well. And so I know all about the Cup Final, how United lost to City, and I know about the cricket, the Lord's Test, the big controversy over David Bairstow's stumping. I don't know if that means anything to you. And I know that Manchester United have just taken one of the Chelsea players. Actually, as I was driving up jet-lagged, I arrived in Heathrow Airport this morning and was driving up feeling a little bit sleepy, so I switched on, and guess what was on? It was Talk Sport. And so I know all about the Manchester United transfers, and I get WhatsApps from people like Mal and Byron just about most days. But I sometimes wonder, like, am I missing some of the nuances of what's going on? You know, some of those finer details. And sometimes when you ask that question, people will tell you a little bit more as to what's going on. And so I managed to keep up with a few Peter Kay jokes along the way. I don't know if he means anything to you, but I think he's a very funny chap. Apparently, he's known for garlic bread. Do you know that? You know, garlic bread. Anyway, that's apparently his dad thinks garlic bread is a really silly thing to eat. Anyway, garlic bread. So I just thought you'd enjoy that one. And I will tell you one other kind of fun story. I was at the All Blacks game in November, and I was sat next to Pastor Chris Bullock, who got us the tickets, and we've been able to go to training a couple of times that week. And this lady sat next to me, and I said, "Oh, where are you from?" She said, "Barry." I said, "I've heard of that." And she said, "Do you mean Gavin and Stacey?" I said, "I've heard of that one as well." So there you go. So I pick up one or two of those things. But I think there's often something much bigger going on than we realize. And I want to say this. I think it's even bigger than the politics. And I know we very easily get drawn into that story. I think it's bigger than some of the celebrities. You know, you can usually tell who the big pop idol of the day is, although if you were watching Glastonbury, most of them were in their 70s. They made us look young, Mal, don't you think? Most of those who are making us give another 20 years there. But I suggest to you that when Israel turned against the Lord, they didn't just become neutral, but what they did was find other gods. And I think that's what happens in America. I think that's what happens in Wales. When we turn away from the Lord, people think, like, I'm now beautifully, rationally, and secular, and I'm completely reasonable and logical, unlike you, completely illogical religious people. But I suggest to you, it doesn't work that way at all. What we often do is replace the Lord with another idol or another god. That's the story of Israel. I think that's also the story of Wales as well. Jesus would often ask the Pharisees, who were in charge at the time. They weren't very spiritual at all, were they, the Pharisees, if you know about them. But he would often ask the question, kind of, by what authority? What's underneath this? Is it that you've just got the power and you're the dominant cultural movement of the day? Or is there some greater authority? And of course, Jesus would always point back to the authority that he has. So here's my question. What's the big story in Wales? I know what it once was. And I know what the big story once was. And Mal's written a beautiful musical about that. Why Me was the original. I think it was recast as Callan Lann, isn't that right? But and Mal would say Evan Roberts was a very genuine man, the real deal. And it affected Abertillery. In 1904, 1905, Evan Roberts became the most famous man in the world. The most famous man in the world was not Tom Jones or you know, some of the Welsh celebrities, but it was a young 26-year-old miner called Evan Roberts, and it profoundly affected Abertillery. In fact, in Abertillery and Ring of Bells, 3,467 people came to know Christ in just a few months. Just imagine that phenomenal movement sweeping this community. And what I love about this building, I've never seen anything like it, was that during the revival in 1904-05, as I've understood it in the past, see this door here? That basically, they opened up an overflow. So this church was full, and And Pastor Jason, we don't compare ourselves to that moment, but I think these stories give us hope. But there was so many people were in this place that they opened up this kind of overflow area. And as you know, in this hall here, they put a balcony around it as well. So you imagine the preacher's up here. People are in a balcony underneath this section here. They couldn't even see anything. I was telling Zeke that story. It's like in our church, you'd be like, "Oh, Betty couldn't see." You know what I mean? And it's like there was just a desire to be together. And so it profoundly affected this nation. And you might be saying, "Pastor, you're talking about some ancient history here." Well, there were some tough times. Originally, there were only 15 young people at the prayer meeting. People were very discouraged. But something happened in the life of Evan Roberts, and people turned to the Lord. And this is what David Smithers says about this story. Though only 26 years old, Evan Roberts had no time for youthful entertainment and pleasure. Day and night, without ceasing, he prayed, wept, and sighed for a great spiritual awakening. Roberts writes, "For 10 or 11 years, I've prayed for revival. I could sit up all night to read or talk about revivals. Often he would simply lead the people in prayer or read the scriptures. Then at other times, he sat silent while one after the other, people confessed their sins or gave testimony of Christ's victory and power." And hasn't Byron given that testimony, and haven't the songs given testimony of that? "There were also glorious times of worship which lasted literally hours. The Holy Spirit was at work. The earnings of workmen, instead of being squandered on drink and vice, were now bringing great joy to their families. Outstanding debts were being paid by thousands of young converts. Restitution was the order of the day. The gambling and the alcohol business lost their trade. The theaters closed down from lack of patronage. Football during this time was forgotten by both players and fans, though nothing was mentioned from the pulpits about it. The people had new lives and new interests. Political meetings were canceled or abandoned. They seemed completely out of the question since nobody was interested." I would say praise the Lord on that one. "The political leaders from Parliament in London abandoned themselves to the revival meetings. One of the outstanding features of the revival," says David Smithers, "was the confession of sin. Not among the unsaved only, but also among the saved. All were broken down and melted before the cross of Christ." Throughout the revival, Evan Roberts constantly stressed the necessity of dealing honestly with sin, complete obedience to the Holy Spirit, and preeminence of the Lord Jesus. Evan Roberts was instrumental in bringing healing to an entire country because he cared and wept and prayed. He embraced the broken heart of God and offered it up to him through prayer and intercession. As a result, wherever he went, hearts were set aflame with the love of God. You know, one of my favorite stories during the revival was that Evan was preaching the cross. He would come back to the cross. He didn't preach just kind of a health and wealth theology. He didn't preach that at all. He didn't just preach like a self-help thing, but he preached the power of the cross. And there was a moment that there was a miner who was listening to the story as if for the first time about Jesus being crucified on the cross. And apparently this miner just cried out. And this word literally means friend, Zeke, because you won't know what butties means. But literally, the miner cried out with tears in his eyes, "Where were his butties?" He was so appalled that Jesus would die alone. And so the message of the cross affected profoundly. Now, I'm telling you that story. I think that should encourage us and should remind us. In fact, there's a song that we sing called "The Same God" that we do in church. Does anyone sing that song in your church, "Same God"? I don't know if you know that. It's a great song. But there's a line that goes, "You moved in power then." Today, as I was driving up the A470 for the first time in a few months, got to near Troy Deroux and Abervan, an area that I know very well. And I just heard the song go in my head, "You moved in power then." And then doesn't the song go, "God, move in power now. You are the same God." And I want to say, if this was actually God that moved in Wales and not just a movement of man or a slightly crazy young man, if it was actually God manifest through that, I would say, you moved in power then, you can move in the present because he is the same God. Amen. Let's give God praise for that story, shall we, everyone? So, okay. One thing, though, I don't think, many of you will have heard talks on the revival before. So what I'm not doing is kind of whipping us into revival frenzy and say we ought to do the same thing now, although I'd be very happy if that did happen. But what is the big story in Wales? Well, can I put it this way? I think we've been through what we would call the Victorian era, and I think it's very easy to knock the Victorians and think everything they did was wrong and terrible and everything. Actually, they invented a lot of good stuff, like the flushing toilet. We're very thankful for that. They invented the train as well. Actually, a Welshman invented the train as well. And so along came the 60s, and you know, the permissive society, and we started saying, and the message was very much, do whatever you want to do as long as it doesn't harm anybody. But we've discovered subsequently there was a lot more harm actually done. I mean, it's a bit hard to watch some of the reruns of Top. I love to watch reruns. You can't really watch a rerun of Top of the Pops anymore, can you? From the 70s, or a number of those episodes, we found it wasn't quite as harmless as we thought it was. And actually, if the Victorians built the trains in the 60s, they closed all the stations down as well, didn't they, along the Welsh? And then the Victorians built those beautiful buildings, and then what happened in the 60s? We built the tower blocks. So I think sometimes we sort of are very nostalgic about when the good old days were, when the good old days weren't. So where are we now? So we went through like the Victorian age, the Edwardian age, carrying well into World War II. So a more traditional morality, that kind of thing. We went through the permissive culture and everything. So where are we now today? Can I suggest where I think we are? And this is why another big reason why we need a revival. I find myself in America, and I see it in Britain as well, see it in Wales as well. I suggest that we now live in a very judgmental age. And it's interesting that you use that phrase. I think we're very judgmental, divisive, angry. I don't think we're really that bothered about truth. We're just bothered about getting our point across. And how's that working out for us? I don't think it's working out for us very well at all. And so what I'm seeing in our culture right now, what I'm seeing in America, is mankind's inability to create a good and healthy grand story. I can only find one source of truth that gives me joy, and that can actually be good for Wales. I believe that Wales has always been at her very best when we seek God, which doesn't mean to say that we're nasty to people that don't seek God, and I think, Byron, you've expressed that beautifully already tonight, but I do believe that we are at our best and are our most influential when we lift our hearts to heaven and we seek the Lord. And so the scripture I want to read for us is, to me, the grandest story of all, the grand story. It's from 1 Corinthians 15. Paul says, "For what I received, I passed on to you as of first importance." He's almost saying, this is the story, and I would love this to be the story for this church and this community. I'd love this to be the story for Wales. This is what I pass on to you as of first importance, that Christ died for our sins. Isn't it interesting at the revival that the cross was central, that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures, and after that, he appeared to more than 500 of the brothers and sisters at the same time, most of whom are still living, though some have fallen asleep. And then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles. And Paul says, and last of all, he appeared to me also, of course, on the Damascus Road. Interesting that you mentioned that as well. As to one abnormally born, says the Apostle Paul. Can I suggest to you, this is the great story that motivated Mary Jones famously to walk many, many miles barefoot, that led to the formation of the Bible story, a little Welsh girl. Who has ever heard that story of Mary Jones? Give me a wave if you know that story. It's a wonderful story. And it led to not just the Bible Society being formed in London, but actually in more than 100 nations, the influence of a little girl who was interested in the Word of God. It wasn't just the 1904-1905 revival, but the 1859 revival was extraordinary. Under Daniel Rowlands many years before, I believe that Wales has often been at her best when we really have put the Lord first and focused on him. There was an intercessor called Rhys Howells and his son Samuel Howells, all connected to the Swansea Bible College. Again, give me a wave if you know anything about this story. Some of the most amazing books I've read. You know when the miracle of Dunkirk was taking place? I'm sure people were praying all over the world, but there was special focused intercession taking place in Swansea that something extraordinary would take place. You can't explain Dunkirk in any other way. There was that miraculous saving of 338,000 men. I think the only way you can ever explain that is in the miracle of Dunkirk. And so I believe Wales has been at her best when we focus on the grand story. Christ has died for sins. He was buried, and he rose again. Mal knows about this. You know, my grandfather was my hero. He was the youngest fly half to play for Wales. Now, his cousin was more famous than my grandpa. He was called Jim Griffiths. He was the MP for Llanelli for about 33 years. He was the deputy head of the Labour Party, and he was actually succeeded by Nye Bevan. He was head of the South Wales Miners and the first minister for Wales. And so I read his biography the other day. Our family managed to get hold of it. And he starts describing the Welsh Revival. I'm thinking, wow, one of my relatives was there in the Welsh Revival, and he describes how the flame came in. And then he said, and then it went away, and he said, and then he said, so we went back to politics. And that was the rest of his life. And there are some that are called to be in that political world. And we need, actually, don't we need good people? And we all need to participate in the process because politics involves every part of life. But I wonder if that's sometimes what we do, that just those things just take hold so strongly that we forget about the grand story. Now, you know, I went to school in Britain, and so I'm very used to all the cynicism, and as a pastor for a lot of years now, I'm used to so many of the questions about the truth of Jesus Christ. And people would often say things like, well, the Bible, you can't trust the Bible because it's like someone just like found the Bible the other day, and it's 2,000 years old, and you can't trust it. And I think sometimes there's a straw man put up that makes the Bible into something that is very unbelievable. I suggest to you that this writing is the first of all the New Testament writings. It was written between 15 and 20 years after the resurrection took place. And my father died about 45 years ago in very tragic circumstances. And I can remember very, very vividly the day the police officer came to our door. We saw the blue light of the police car drive over, just I could see it over the top of the fence. And the police officer arrived with our neighbor, Peggy. And I can still see the look on her face that day. Walked into the house. My grandmother was there, grandfather was there, my mum was there. I took my sister upstairs. Mum said, take Sophie upstairs. We sat in one of the rooms there, and I could hear the rain come down on the magnolia leaves outside, knowing that there was some bad news being delivered into my family. And I could go on and on and on, talk all about in great detail, all those things that took place over those next few days that were so influential in my life. And some people try and say, well, the disciples, they were kind of confused and they were grief-stricken, all those kinds of things. Can I say, when you go through those kind of events, you remember everything. It's vivid. And you've been through some grief, haven't you? And I'm so sorry about your son. And I'm so thankful that he did know the Lord and he was able to come along to some of our events together. But don't you agree that you just remember those things vividly? And I suggest the 1 Corinthians 15, when Paul says, what I received, I passed on as of first importance. This was truth that was passionately held by the church. And it was not only the great story for the apostles, who one moment were running away, and the next moment were willing to die. Do you know why? Because Jesus died for sins and was buried, and they knew it. And he rose again. It was the grand story for the apostles, and it was actually the grand story for the greatest movement in human history. And for a long time, it was the grand story in Wales. We could lose sight of it, and we do lose sight of it, but I want to encourage the faithful few who are gathered today that Jesus Christ is alive, Byron. You hit the nail on the head. And I want to encourage us that this can be the grand story for us again. So can I go over it again? Christ died. Can I just remind you, Jesus Christ is the greatest person who ever lived. C.S. Lewis said, it would take a Jesus to imitate a Jesus. Do you notice that when people mock people's names, they don't mock Buddha or Winston Churchill or Gary Barlow, but they say the name of Jesus Christ? It's a really strange thing that people will do that, but I suggest to you that when people do that, they don't even realize the significance of what they're saying. What they're saying, it's not the right way to say it, but there is a real God, and his name is Jesus, and he lived the greatest life that was ever lived. When I was at school, we used to do religious education. Give me a wave if you used to do religious education at school. And we had this teacher called Miss Sabatini, and before I became a Christian, Miss Sabatini actually encouraged us to think, when we looked at the miracles of Jesus, she would say, well, try and find an alternative to how this could have been misunderstood by the disciples. So we looked at the walking on the water. And our class, I remember my friend Al, who became a Christian, led me to Christ a few years later, we would say, well, maybe Jesus was at low tide. Do you know what I mean? There's the glistening sand, and they thought he was walking on the water. Or maybe Jesus was like walking on a pier. I mean, like, there must be a pier there somewhere in the Sea of Galilee. And we came up with all these ideas, and we started to realize how ridiculous our ideas were, because the plain fact is that the apostles knew that Jesus walked on the water. And I suggest to you that his was the greatest life that there's ever been. Do you know that there are more than 300 prophecies fulfilled in the life of Jesus Christ? And those prophecies about the crucifixion of Jesus Christ in the Old Testament, crucifixion wasn't even a known thing at that point. And yet it was prophesied that he would be crucified for our sins. I believe that the grand story needs to be about Jesus Christ. Let your story, I know the world's talking about all kinds of other stuff and they'll change their mind the next year. Let your grand story be Jesus Christ and how he died for sins. Sins? Garlic bread, you might say. How can we talk about sin today? What is sin? Sin is very close to every one of us. It's never a friend. Sin will always take you further than you want to go. But sin are those things that you know you should do and you don't do. Sin is when there's something that you know you shouldn't do and you do it anyway. Jesus said, sometimes you're so bothered about the speck in someone else's eye, and you can't even see the great big plank in your own eye. Do you do that as well sometimes, my friend? Give me a wave if that's you. I know I can do that so easily. And the very thing that you're pointing out in somebody else, sometimes you're doing it because you know there's something in your own life. 1 John 1 says, if we claim that we've not sinned, the truth is not within us. In that case, there's a lot of truth missing in our land, because it seems to me that everybody wants to think that the problem that I have with guilt in my life will be taken away if only people would get off my back. The fact is that there is a real God, and if we've sinned against him, then the only way to have that sin dealt with is not to deny it or pretend it never happened, but to be forgiven and to receive forgiveness in Jesus Christ. Now, I had this really nice dentist when we lived in Hove, and I won't mention his name, but he was such a nice guy, and he was recommended, and I'd go and see him, and he said, Reese, he says, your teeth are great. And this was like 3 years running. I'd go to the dentist, and everything was great, and I kept saying to Louise, I've got the best dentist. He's so kind to me. He gives me free toothpaste. He gives me a toothbrush, and I haven't had to pay him anything except for the checkup. And then I heard from another friend of his that things weren't going very well for him. And the story was that this particular dentist, he was making his money not by doing the work, but just by giving everyone a checkup and saying, you're good, and he wasn't actually doing the work. So I found another dentist, well, because he stopped being a dentist, right? And so I went to this other dentist, a South African, and, he was a really mean dentist, my South African friend. And he told me that I had tooth decay. And he showed me the x-rays. And it turned out this chap previously had not been doing his job. And so I remember having 5 fillings, 5 big, deep fillings. And I had all kinds of other stuff going on. It took a long time, a lot of money. Now, let me ask you, which do you think was the best dentist? Who wants the first dentist? I think most of the world goes like, give me the first dentist. I didn't sin. Don't tell me I sinned. Don't tell me there's a problem. But actually, we do need the good dentist to go, all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. The wonderful message is that Christ died for sinners. The greatest thing is that God is not like all, God just doesn't want to be judgy with us. God is holy and he is full of judgment. But the wonderful thing is that God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Let that be the grand story, that Christ died for sinners, that he died for your sin. And let the grand story be that he was buried. And you know, there was going to be a rumor that was going to break out, like, oh, he didn't really die. And so some of the leaders went to Pilate and they said, we don't want any rumors breaking out across the city. We want this Jesus to be dead and buried. And so Pilate goes, right, we're going to post a guard. We've got the most powerful force in the world. We're going to put a great big stone. We're going to seal it. And some people believe that was like a wax seal. And the penalty for breaking that wax seal was death. All the disciples had run away anyway, so as to why they would want to even steal the body or do anything like that. So there is Jesus with a great big, in a tomb. He's buried. Great big stone, seal, run with soldiers, then Jesus Christ is raised from the dead. The perfect test for the resurrection was saved. And I believe the grand story is that Jesus Christ died for sinners, was buried, and rose again. And then he appeared. We have the Bible record of at least 9 resurrection appearances, and on one occasion, 500 people. You imagine a little stir that could be taken because there were 70 people gathering who saw something remarkable. Imagine 500 people, the influence that would have on Abitaleri and Ringer Bells. Most of them were still living, and so they were testimonies of the fact that they had seen the risen Lord Jesus. Jesus appeared to them, and then, of course, he ascended to heaven. He's at the right hand of the Father, and he's coming back. And if you're thankful for that story, would you give God praise, everybody? Can you give him praise? That means clap and give glory to God. So, my proposal is, in this very judgmental era, that we believe in our heart of hearts, and Pastor Zeke's going to come and close us out with some music. But my proposal is that we believe the great story, the story for the world, the story for Wales, the story for your family. In the midst of all the craziness that's going on around us, we may be a few that choose a narrow way that leads to life, but I'm telling you, when you got the life, like Byron says, you don't want anything else. It is better than a grand slam, because you can get those things and the glory's gone very, very quickly. But I thank God that with Jesus we have everlasting life. And so once before, our country was caught up with that grand story. And there would have been some emotion with that. There would have been some, like, just humanness that went with that. But deep down, it was the cross of Jesus Christ that was making a difference. What happened? Well, do you know, a lot of our young men were killed in the Great War. It was especially a movement of young men. And so I do want you to know that heaven was populated because of those young men that came to Christ and then died in the Somme and some of those places from 1914 to 1918. But the stories continue to go across the world, and there have been perpetual revivals ever since. And the Welsh revival is seen as a very significant point in spiritual history, that this has been an era of revivals. Do you know where the biggest revival is taking place right now, as far as we know? It's in Iran. When I was at college, I remember we had someone who was praying for Iran, and there were known to be only 50 believers in Iran. There's more than 1 million believers in Iran, most of them in the last few years. And so revivals are still breaking out across the world. I believe it's more than just a human movement. I believe it's the power of God at work through the good message of the grand story that Jesus died, was buried, and rose again. So I'm going to ask us just to bow our heads before the Lord right now. So what do we do about this? That same chapter says, by this gospel you are saved. And if that's you, if most here in the room today are believers, by this gospel you are saved. Then the next says, if you hold firmly to the word I preach to you. If you hold firmly to the word, otherwise you've believed in vain. Can I just encourage you, believe if you're a believer, and hold firmly to the word. Don't be distracted by the gods of this day, but trust the grand story. Jesus died, was buried, and rose again. So I'm going to ask, if you are a believer, to hold firm. I think a visual symbol of that would be just to put your hand, look at me like now, just put your hand like this, like I'm holding firm to the word. Just with your own praying right now, just hold firmly to the word. And I'll pray a prayer for you. Father God, help me to keep trusting in you. Help me to have faith in you. Help me, Lord, to believe, even when others don't. Help me to hold out the word of life to others. Lord, for every one of us, deliver us from doubt. Give us encouragement. And there may just be someone here, and this has all been like, whoa, I never even heard this kind of stuff. But if you've never really given your life to Jesus right now, can I just pray a prayer that I prayed when I was 14 years old, when I gave my life to Jesus? Just pray this prayer with me right now. Dear Lord, I recognize that I've sinned against you. I've done things I shouldn't do. I've done things I shouldn't have done. I've neglected things I should have done. Lord, please forgive me. Jesus, thank you that you died on the cross. Thank you that you were buried and you rose again. Risen Lord, come into my life and help me to follow you. Help me to give you praise in all of my life. If you pray that prayer, I'm going to ask, hey, why not just put your hand up and say, you know, that's me. I prayed that prayer. I gave my life to Jesus by asking him to forgive me of my sins and to come into my life. Put your hand up if that's you. So just look around here. That's wonderful. God bless you. God sees your hand right now, and he knows that you're trusting in him. That's a wonderful thing. I'm so thankful. And Father God, I want to pray for this church. I thank you for Ebenezer and, Lord, all the amazing things that have been done in this place through the years. And, Lord, going through some of the most challenging times in this church's history, we pray for Pastor Jason, Lord, that you give him faith and encouragement, that you bless his family and bless the congregation. And, Lord, may your favor be upon this church. May your favor be upon Abbot Tulare and the surrounding regions. Lord, for all the events taking place tonight, we ask for people to come to know you, people to be encouraged, people to be built up in the holy faith. And we pray, Father, for all the other events taking place over these few days. So, Lord, thank you for all that you've done tonight. Thank you for the amazing testimony and the wonderful music we've heard tonight. We pray that you'll have all the glory and all the praise. In Jesus' name. Pastor Zeke, are we just about done? You got another song, or should we just say amen? Amen. Well, let's praise the Lord one more time. Thank you for coming, everyone. And please, I hope we can get to see you as the days go by.
Thank you.